Geraldine Fitzgerald.
The bridge down by the river, with arches overhead, it's home like there. To me, that's where each night I make my bed. It's just a friendly jungle. It has an open door, a lovely spot. Drop in, why not? There's always room for more. Underneath the arches, I dream my dreams away. Underneath the arches, on cobblestones I lay. Every night you'll find me tired out and worn, happy when the daylight comes creeping, heralding the dawn. Sleeping when it's raining and sleeping when it's fine, I hear the trains rattling by above. The pavement is my pillow, no matter where I roam. Underneath the arches is where I make my home. Thank you. Good evening. Good evening, friends. And indeed, you are friends to come out on such a terrible night. I welcome you all, and I'm very touched that so many of you made it. Such an awful evening. That was a London street song that you were listening to. It's about a shopping bag lady who lives under a bridge down by the River Thames in London. And before I go any further into the act, I would like to clarify a little bit what I mean by street songs. Because people are always asking me, they say, what are they about? I mean, are they going to be about the ecology? I mean, are they about automobile exhausts? Are they about smog? Are they about dogs on the sidewalk? Or they say, I know, you come out with a lute with a lot of colored ribbons hanging on it, and you sing songs that go, by my wild strawberries, oh. And I say, no, I don't mean that at all. The street songs that I'm going to sing are not like that at all. Street songs to me are the songs that all of us sing in the street when we feel like singing in the street. In other words, street songs are popular songs from all time and from all places. And if we feel like singing opera, why, we kind of popularize it if we're going to do it in the street. Now, when I was a child growing up in Dublin in Ireland, there was no television then, and there was no radio, and if you weren't well off, you didn't even have a phonograph. And so the way we entertained ourselves and each other was by singing in the streets of Dublin. And the place we got our material from was from the music hall, because once a year our parents would take us to the theater, and it usually was a variety act of some kind. And we'd watch all the people singing and dancing, and then in the coming year we would try to copy it. Now, the act that we liked the best was the one where the old timer would come from London on her annual farewell tour to Dublin. And she would come out on the stage. She always brought the house down. And looking back, you know, I can't imagine why, because she never did anything. But she always looked as if she might. For me, down Forget Me Not Lane. Fortune never comes that way. I'll keep singing.
singing this song all day, keeping troubles away from Forget Me Not Lane. It's just a heaven they've made, and if you're a stranger there, you'll find a table well laid, and you're welcome to a chair. There's no highbrow etiquette, just plain people, and once you've met, they will never forget down Forget Me Not Lane. For me down Forget Me Not Lane, I'll keep singing this song all day, it's just a heaven they've made, and if you're a stranger there, you'll find a table well laid, and you're welcome to a chair. There's no highbrow etiquette, just plain people, and once you've met, they will never forget, don't forget me not lane. Forget me not, Lane.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Now, I was saying earlier that we used to watch everything and imitate it. Well, sometimes we couldn't imitate it because we hadn't remembered it properly. So we used to fill in, you know, by going la 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 la. And that's what people in the street always do. There's a whole series of songs that I call la 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 songs. I mean, who in this room has never, at one time or another, not wanted to ask, what's it all about? I feel la la la, la la la. Well, Alfie doesn't know, they don't know, nobody knows. But it sounds good. And sometimes, as I say, you want to sing opera, and so you go, one fine day you will notice, la 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 la. We don't know what we notice. All we know is you have tears are pouring down our face. There's one song that everybody in the room can sing, but only can sing la la la. No one in this room knows the words of this song. The late, great Edith Piaf used to sing it, but she sung it in French, so that's no help. The name of the song is The Poor People of Paris. And even if you hear it on the radio, they just, on some kind of instrumental record, nobody sings it. And if they do, they whistle it or hum it or something. And indeed, I thought that it didn't have any English words. But I researched it, and it does. But they're not what you'd think. I mean, the title, The Poor People of Paris, that makes you think it must be about the financially disadvantaged citizens of the capital city of France. But it's not. The English lyric of The Poor People of Paris is about an American tourist from the dry belt. He's been to Paris, he didn't like it, and now he's going to give a report to the hometown folks. Just got back from Paris, France. All they do is sing and dance. All they've got there is romance. What a tragedy. Every boulevard has lovers. Every lover's in a trance. The poor people of Paris. Milk and water from the sink makes your true Parisian shrink. Wine is all they'll ever drink, and it worries me. For with wine as cheap as water, well, it makes you stop and think. The poor people of Paris. I feel sorry for the French in the park, garçon and wench, occupying every
revenge, kissing shamelessly. Night and day they're making music while they're making love in French. The poor people of Paris. So don't go to Paris, France, not unless you like to dance, not unless you want romance. La 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 la. Like those poor inhabitants of Paris. La 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 la.
Thank you very much. Amongst the songs that they sing in the street are songs about leaving, which in a great city like this, so many of us did do, and then our yearning to go home again, which have succeeded in doing. So I'm going to sing two songs right together. One of them is about by the Beatles, and it's about leaving home, and one of them is by Weber and Rice, and it's about going home. Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock, as the day begins, silently closing her bedroom door, leaving the note that she hoped would say more. She goes down the stairs to the kitchen, clutching her handkerchief. Quietly turning the back door key, stepping outside, she is free. She's leaving home. We gave her all of our lives, sacrificed all of our lives. We gave her everything money could buy. She's leaving home after living alone for so many years. Father snores as his wife gets into her dressing gown, picks up the letter that's lying there, standing alone at the head of the stairs. She breaks down and cries to her husband, "Daddy, our baby's gone. How could she treat us so thoughtlessly? How could she do this to me?" She's leaving home. We never thought of ourselves. Never a thought of ourselves. We struggled hard all of our lives to get by. She's leaving home after living alone for so many years. Friday morning at 9 o'clock, she is far away, waiting to keep an appointment she made, meeting a man from the auto trade. She's having fun. What did we do that was wrong? We never did anything wrong. We might forgive if we only understood why. Something inside that was always denied for so many years. She's leaving home.
She's leaving home. She's leaving home. Bye, bye. Bye.
It won't be easy. You'll think it's strange when I try to explain how I feel, that I still need your love after all that I've done. You won't believe me. All you will see is a girl you once knew, although she's dressed up to the nines at sixes and sevens with you. I had to let it happen. I had to change. Couldn't stay all my life down at heel, looking out of the window, staying out of the sun. So I chose freedom, running around trying everything new, but nothing impressed me at all. I never expected it to. Don't cry for me, I'm returning. The truth is I never left you. Through all my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. And as for fortune, and as for fame, I never invited them in, though it seemed to the world they were all I desired. They are illusions. They're not the solutions they promised to be. The answer was here all the time. I love you and hope you love me. Don't cry for me, I'm returning. The truth is I never left you. Through all my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. Have I said too much? There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But all you have to do is look at me to know that every word is true. I'm going to take off my skirt and I'm going to introduce the band. Now, I mightn't do it in that order. And anyway, those two things aren't related, you know. Well, first of all, I think I will introduce the band. I've come in from Connecticut tonight and nearly got marooned and snowbanked and everything. And first off, I'm going to introduce the person who arrived first, who is our brilliant and wonderful young man who plays the strings. And his name is Greg Utzig. And then on the woodwinds is a young man who was a child prodigy in the rock world. He used to travel around the country when he was really very small in knee pants. And now, although he looks very wise, he's not all that much older. And he is the amazing and talented Tom Myers. And then at the piano is our musical director, who has his own cabaret in Bridgeport called the Bridgeport Cabaret, which he did tonight before he came in. And he is a composer and an arranger, and he also plays all the instruments that exist and a few that maybe don't. And a couple of seasons ago, was the musical director for the Broadway play Poor Murderer. He's a brilliant young man, and his name is Stanley Wiatrakowski. Comes the promised strip. I hope. Oh, yes, there we are. The reason I did that is I want to show you all an Irish red petticoat. That's what it looks like. That's what it is. It's not made of silk or linen. It's made of wool. And you never get to see it in Ireland because on weekdays it's three quarters covered by a skirt. And on festive occasions it's entirely covered because no matter what it's made of, it is a petticoat. And as a matter of fact, if we were in Galway tonight, the act would be rated X. And I want you to, especially I wanted to have it on, because I'm going to sing you a song about an Irish party. You know, Ireland's very, very famous for parties. And the parties in Galway, where this petticoat comes from, are the most famous because they go on for 3 days and three nights. And I know that's true because when I was a kid, I went to one once. I think most people only go to one once, because their constitutions wouldn't stand up to any more than that. And at this party that I went to, they told me that in that same house 50 years before, on the first night of the three-day party, one of the guests, having overtrained, and even though not everybody in this room is Irish, everybody knows what that means, he had overtrained and he had fallen over the balcony, the stair rail, on the first night down into the cellar. And sorry to tell you, he was killed. And even sorrier to tell you that he was buried where he fell. And the reason, this is really a true story, the reason for this unusual funeral was that it was the first night of the three-day party. If it had been the second or even the third night, he'd have had your more conventional internment. But we all know it is very difficult to get a party going. And once you have, you're not going to let a little thing like that get in your way. Now, here is a song about another Irish party. Have you heard of Phil the Fluter? Of the town of Ballybock? The times were going hard with him.
What? Any time? You're on Tusha?
Since 1934, Geraldine Fitzgerald has appeared in more than 35 films and a countless number of stage plays. American audiences first became familiar with her when she left Europe and came to Warner Brothers in 1939. She made two films that year, Wuthering Heights and Dark Victory, in which you may remember she was there in the garden when the clouds rolled by, the lights went out, and Bette Davis succumbed to that dreadful movie disease. She's currently appearing on Broadway with Jason Robards and O'Neill's A Touch of the Poet. And at the same time, she's doing her cabaret act here nightly at Reno Sweeney's. We're happy to have her with us this evening. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm very pleased to be here.
Geraldine, where do you get the stamina to keep a schedule like this?
Well, I don't know. I think I have a lot of energy, and I'm not aware that I have any more than anybody else, except that people come and tell me that I do. I always imagine everybody is the same as me.
But you keep a schedule in it.
The whole new tech. Great.
That's the beginning.
Can you believe it? Anytime. Okay.
Since 1934, Geraldine Fitzgerald has appeared in more than 35 films and a countless number of stage plays. American audiences first became familiar with her when she left Europe and came to Warner Brothers in 1939. She made two films that year, Wuthering Heights and Dark Victory, in which you may remember she was there in the garden when the clouds rolled by, the lights went out, and Bette Davis succumbed to that famous movie disease. She's currently appearing on Broadway with Jason Robards in O'Neill's A Touch of the Poet, and at the same time, she's performing her cabaret act nightly here at Reno Sweeney's. We're happy to have her with us this evening. Good evening.
Good evening, Frank.
Well, let's try to take two will work out a little better.
Yes.
Let me ask you again, where do you get the stamina to do this night after night?
Well, I'm not aware that I have any more energy than other people, but people ask me that question, though, frequently, and so perhaps I do. It doesn't seem to be any particular effort to me.
You're doing the show six evenings and one matinee?
Two matinees.
Touch of the Poet, two
yes,
matinees.
Yes.
And
then coming on down here, just doing one show, the midnight show. I just have a lot of energy, I guess, but I always thought everybody did. It comes as a kind of surprise that...
Everybody doesn't. There's a superstar in town this very moment with the flu.
Oh, I'm very sorry for her. Because, first of all, I admire her enormously. But even if I didn't, the flu this year is horrible, and I wouldn't wish it on anyone. And I think it's magnificent of her that she ever did her act at all with it. In our company, several members of our company have had flu, and they have played. But then they're not singing, and it's been hard enough for them to do whatever speaking they have to do. It's an awful flu. So I hope she's soon better.
I don't believe I've ever had the flu in my life.
I don't get it.
You call your cabaret material Streetsongs.
Yes, I do. Because they're the kind of songs that people, if they wanted to sing in the streets, would sing. They're basic songs. They're popular songs. I love popular art. I always have. And I love popular music. And this is popular music from all time. I mean, Danny Boy goes back to 2,500 years. And the Beatles song that I sing and the song called Don't Cry For Me, I'm Returning. Well, I don't think that has even been heard much, the second of the two songs. And Annie is full of street songs, and Brecht wrote street songs. Everybody writes street songs. It's popular music.
Tell me something about street theater.
Oh, street theater is different. Street theater was a concept that a colleague of mine, Jonathan Ringkamp, and I brought into being about 7 or 8 years ago. And it's a way of involving the community in the performing arts. Instead of bringing in a play into a community, we go into the community and we bring the community out. In other words, the community writes the music and choreographs the work. And they are the performers. And we have one central concept, which is that we never try out or audition. If anybody wants to be part of our company, just by saying that they wish to be, that's all that's necessary.
I guess it's a little less intimidating for them.
Yes, and I remember when I was a child, it seemed to me that down the block, there were always wonderful things going on, and you always had to try out for them, and I always felt it wasn't even worth attempting it, that I wouldn't be accepted. I was that kind of a child, and I don't believe I was unique. And so I carried within me the idea that I would like to have something one day that nobody, whether they were a child or an old person, would ever feel left out of. So that's what motivated that concept.
When did you begin singing? I mean, did you just decide to do
I began to learn to sing about 10 years ago, and then I began to sing in public about 5 years ago.